We're going to continue our new series here on the book of 1 Timothy, how to get the most out of church. And we've looked already at a little background of Timothy himself and the Apostle Paul. And last week we focused on the whole idea that you got to get into the Word. But the purpose of the letter is listed about halfway through the book. He says, although I hope to come to you, Paul speaking, I hope to come to you soon, Timothy, I am writing these instructions so that if I am delayed, you will know how people ought to conduct themselves in God's house, which is the church of the living God. 1 Timothy is giving us the instruction manual of how to do church. And if you want to get the most out of church, you're going to do church the way God wants you to do church. And so we're looking at how to get the most out of church. Now last time, we spent the first 11 verses of the first chapter focusing on the fact that you got to be in the Word. You got to be in the Word. Now, we still have out at Grand Central in the narthex there, the Read Through the Bible Guide. And you can pick one up, and so you're already almost 2 weeks behind. So I would just jump in right on today's date if you haven't started, and just start from there and move your way through. And when you get all done, go back and pick those up. That way you'll be on schedule, all right? And anytime you get off schedule, you see what I do is I cross them off as I read them. And then I guess, if I'm off, I can jump down, stay on schedule, and then when I got free time, go back and pick up those chapters. But I want to encourage you to read through the Word. So as we looked at last time, if you want to get the most out of church, you have got to be in the Word of God. You've got to be in the Bible. You got to build yourself up on the most holy faith. Now, today, if you want to get the most out of church, you have to focus on salvation. You have to focus on salvation. In fact, that's what he's going to talk about in the remainder portion of the first chapter of 1 Timothy, is that we have to focus on salvation. You see, salvation is at the heart of it all. So I'm going to skip down a few verses and jump into the middle of the section that we're taking the message from today. And in the 15th verse, he says, salvation is the heart of it all. Here is a trustworthy saying, and it deserves all acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. I want to talk about salvation for a moment. We were on family vacation. I was about 12 years old. I have an older brother. He's 3 years older than me, so he's 15. And I'm at the Niagara Falls, and you know, on the Canadian side, and I'm at the very edge, and there's a railing there. If you've been there, you know what I'm talking about. And it's right at the very part where the falls curl over, and I'm standing at that part, and I'm leaning over, and I'm acting like I could touch it. And my idiot brother, you'll find out why I call him idiot brother, he runs up behind me, grabs me, and goes like this, hanging on to me tightly, and then pulls me back and said, I saved you. I wanted to turn around and beat my brother to death. That was Heart Attack City. I thought I was going down. The truth is, he did save me. He also caused the predicament that I was in to save me from it. It's kind of like the guy that sets the fire so he can put the fire out, you see? That's what my brother was doing. But he did save me. Now, if he had slipped and let go, he wouldn't have saved me, right? I don't care how much. He could have told my mom and dad all the excuses in the world, and they wouldn't have bought that because he would not have saved me. Salvation is rescuing something from its a condition of perishing, no matter what it is. I could rescue a dog. I could be a fireman, go into a fire and rescue a person. But if I don't actually deliver and they are not rescued, then they're not saved. You're not a savior. But the first thing, the savior is at the heart of it all. Here's the condition we were in. We were born on the very edge, teetering over. In fact, we had already fallen. We're in a condition that theologians call fallen. We've fallen over the edge. We need a Savior to reach out and snag us and pull us up from the abyss below, to catch us and rescue us. We need the Savior. That's exactly what Jesus Christ is. Notice the text says, this is a trustworthy saying, Christ Jesus. He has two titles. The word Christ means to be anointed. He's been anointed of God. He's the anointed one. That's also called Messiah. Messiah is a Hebrew word. Christ is the Greek word. He's the anointed one. That's what the terms mean. He's the anointed one of God. And then his name is Jesus. Old Testament name is Joshua, Yeshua. And what it means is it's two words slammed together. It's the word Yah from Yahweh, and it's the word saves, so that you join them together. It's the Lord saves, Jehovah saves. Jesus' name is Savior. He is God who saves, the anointed one who saves, a mission from God. Jesus Christ, Christ Jesus, that's who it is. I notice here it says he came into the world. Now, we all know John 3:16. I haven't seen them lately, but where the guys in the end zones, you know, I watch football, and they lift up the sign, it says John 3:16. I haven't seen a guy for a while. Remember, he used to wear the funny hat and all of that? And so he gets that attention. The most quoted verse in all the Bible, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, his only begotten son. Notice what the text says. God gave, this text says, Jesus Christ came. The Father gave him, but the Son came. In the eternal counsel of God, the Father determined that the Son would be sent into the world. And the Son said, when God said, who wants to go? The Son raised his hand and said, here am I, send me. He came. He came. In John, it says he voluntarily laid his life down for his sheep. He voluntarily came into the world when the Father sent him into the world so that he could go to the cross and die on the cross to pay the debt that we owed, the debt of our sin. Jesus Christ came into the world in an unusual way. We just celebrated this at Christmas time, didn't we? He didn't come to a palace because he's the Lamb of God. You don't find it. Lambs are not born in a palace. Lambs are born in a stable. The mission that he was on in coming is that he was going to be the Lamb of God to take away the sin of the world. Christ Jesus came into the world. We celebrated that at Christmas, and we just did that. He came, and that was destination was the world, but he came to save, to rescue. Like I was at the Niagara Falls, and I was falling over. His mission was to snag us and catch us before we hit the bottom of the abyss. To save us, to be our rescuer. Now, notice the next part is not really politically correct. To save sinners. Sinners. Nobody likes to be called a sinner. It's just funny the way the language works. No one wants to be called a sinner, but yet we'll use the term all the time in a really good, that is just so sinfully delicious. Well, that's okay. That's politically correct. Because it is just so good that it's bad. I mean, you see what I'm saying? But to say, hey, you're a sinner is quite offensive. And the Bible is not too concerned about being politically correct. It is very much concerned about being very forthright, honest, and truthful. And the Bible says Christ Jesus came in to rescue sinners. Now, the word sin here is hamartia. And hamartia, the Greek word, actually means to fall short. So I set up a target. And I set the target up. And let's say you're an archer or you're a marksman, maybe you're a sharpshooter, and you're shooting at the target. If you don't hit the bullseye, you have sinned. You did hamartia. You missed the goal. You missed the bullseye. And the Bible says, that's what sin is. Anything that you do that misses the bullseye, it calls sin. You're hamartia. You've fallen short. You missed the goal. In fact, that's the definition. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The glory of God is the goal. The goal, the target, the bullseye. Jesus put it this way. Be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Did you catch that target? You see what you're aiming at? Now, I might have most of you here convinced that I'm perfect, but my wife will tell you otherwise. All right? Now, you can believe that you're perfect. You know, it's so funny. Women, they get up and they look and they, oh, man, I look so horrible. I got my makeup on. Oh, I just can't do anything with my hair. Guy gets up, he rubs his hand over and said, man, world, look out for me. One handsome dude hitting the world today. You see, you might have that attitude that, man, I'm perfect. But the Bible says all have sinned. We all missed the bullseye. Here's the bullseye. Be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Here's the bullseye. Be holy as I am holy. You see, the standard is not me. It's not Billy Graham. It's not Mother Teresa. I don't know, whoever you want to stand. The standard is, the bullseye, the target is, you got to be as holy as God, as perfect as God. And if you fall short of that, you're a sinner. You see, when God created Adam, he was completely holy, absolutely righteous. And he held everything he knew in absolute truth and knowledge. But when he rebelled against God, he fell into sin. And that falling into imperfection is passed on to everyone. That's why you don't have to teach a child to do anything wrong. It comes by nature. We were born with this harmartia nature. I'm inclined and have a bent towards doing what is wrong. I'm self-centered. I'm selfish. All these things that go on that are contrary to who God is. And so that's been passed on to all, and we're all sinners. But the Apostle Paul says, of whom I am the worst. I'm the worst. Later he's going to say, I'm a blasphemer, I'm a persecutor, I try to destroy the church of God. He says all things about himself. I think perhaps the biggest thing is that he was self-righteous. He thought he was okay. He thought that he was religiously good. In Philippians, it says that when it came to keeping the law, I was blameless. I dotted every I. I crossed every T. I did every jot and every tittle of the law. Later he'll say, but there's just one that was really killing me, and that was covetousness. I couldn't control my heart. He was so self-righteous, he was out persecuting the church because he thought he was doing a good thing, but he didn't really know Jesus. And when you think you're right and you are wrong, boy, you're in a really bad situation. You realize that? The first place of salvation is that the person has to realize, I have fallen short. Unless I acknowledge that I'm a sinner, I have no need for a Savior. I'm fine. We go on in the passage and it says, but that was the very reason I was shown mercy. I was the worst of all. He says, now, mercy is a legal term. Okay? God, mercy is withholding the justice you deserve. And I got the gavel here. It's the judge is saying, guilty, boom. But as a hand is going down, the hand of Jesus grabs the gavel and says, wait a minute, hold everything. I took his place when I died on the cross. I've already paid the price. Hold. Don't give him what he deserves because I already took in his place what he deserves. You see, the word mercy means holding back the justice and the judgment that we deserve, rightfully so. But instead of placing it upon me, God placed it on Jesus, and he suffered, he bled, and he died so that the penalty of my sin was taken by him. He says, but for this very reason, God showed me mercy. He goes on and he says, I am the worst of sinners, and he showed this mercy to me that Christ Jesus might display his unlimited patience as an example of those who would believe on him and receive eternal life. Listen, Paul says, I am a trophy in the showcase of what God does in changing a person from being a blatant sinner to being what we would call a holy saint. And the truth is, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you are in the showcase. I'm in the showcase. I accepted Jesus Christ. He was merciful to me, and He radically changed my life. He's constantly still working on me. He's still polishing up, so there's a little more luster, a little more glow. And it shows His patience, because I'm not quite finished yet. He's still merciful to me. His unlimited patience, and He was an example to those who would believe on Him. You see, there are people outside our church who don't know Jesus. The only Jesus that they see is you. And we are the showcase. He's putting us out on a spectacle and saying, look at their lives. And when they see this radical change that took place in my life, they're saying, if God could change Dennis, He can surely change me. If God could change Paul, He can surely change me. If God could change Timothy, He can surely change me. You see, we are a showcase. God is displaying His mercy in us. And that's why I can say, man, I blew it. You know, years ago, I had a lot of mistakes. But I had one that resulted in two of my friends dying. Okay, dying. But if God could save me, He could save you. If God can pardon me, He can pardon you. If God can clear my guilty conscience, He can clear yours too. You see, I'm a showcase of what God can do. And then He says the salvation thing is all for His glory. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. This one statement is just packed with theology. It's just packed with theology. He is King. I like what Daniel calls Him. He is the Most High God. He's sovereign. He's above all others. He's eternal. No beginning, no end, always was. He is immortal. He is not subject to death. He will never die. God never dies. He is invisible. You can't see Him. He is spirit, Jesus said in John 4. And they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and truth. By definition, a spirit is invisible. You can't see it. You can't see a spirit. I have a spirit, and you don't see it. You see the shell that my spirit lives in. It's called the body. All right? And then He says, be honor and glory. If there is one place on the planet Earth that there should be glory brought to the Lord Jesus Christ, it's right here at Bethany. Because we are the people who know this God, and we know His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He is our Savior. This salvation thing is huge. You see, when we have this salvation, we embrace this Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and He is our Savior, that salvation makes us thank you. I don't work to get saved. There's not a thing I can do to get saved. Jesus did it all. I can only accept and receive what He's done. It's like a gift at Christmas. When you give the gift, the person doesn't say, oh, wait, let me pay you for that. Why? No, no. Did it cost them something? In most cases, yeah, maybe they made it. But they give it to you freely, and all you can do is receive it. If you even, let's say you were one of those fortunate ones like in the commercials on television, you got the car with the big bow on top of it for Christmas, and you reached in your pocket and you said, here, I'll give you $1 for it. It would no longer, I mean, how would you insult anybody like that? But suppose you did and they accepted the $1, you'd walk away, man, did I get a deal? What a bargain. I got that car for $1. When you do that, it's not grace. It's works. And the Bible says we are saved by grace, not by works. So if I don't work for it, then what do I do? Well, the next day I write a thank you note. And I say, thank you for the gift that you have given me. I live my whole life as a thank you note, saying, thank you, Lord Jesus, for dying on the cross and giving me salvation so rich and free. It's all free. It's a big thank you note. He says, I thank him for his strength. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who has given me strength. Now, in Romans chapter 3, verse 11, it says, there's none righteous, no, not one. There's none who seek after God. There's none who understand. I'm thinking of the wrong verse. Romans chapter 5, verse 6, it says, when we were yet without strength, when we were without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. Scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God demonstrated his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You see, when I was without strength, I could do nothing to save myself. Absolutely nothing. Baptism doesn't save me. You can be baptized every day of your life, and that won't save you. Tithing won't save you. You can tithe everything. You can double tithe, triple tithe. You can do a 10-time tithe. Can't go any higher than that because that's all everything, okay? And that won't save you. You can try to be a good person, the best person that ever lived. That won't save you. Because the Bible tells us, there's none righteous, no, not one. There's none that understand. There's none that seek after God. There's none that does good. And when it says that, it's not none that does good enough. Why? Be perfect, as your Father in heaven is perfect. Be holy, as God is holy. You can never meet that standard. See, you were without strength. Without strength. It's kind of like if I were falling over the Niagara Falls. I could be trying to save myself. I'm in that gushing water going down. I need the hand of Jesus to pull me out. Rescue me. When I was without strength, he rescued me. He's the one that's given me the strength. And he considered me faithful. God considered me. When I think of this, I think of David. David, God saved him, and he was the least likely in the family to be the king. In fact, when Samuel went to anoint the king of Israel, Jesse brought all of his sons before him, and he went down through the whole slew of them, and he said, the king's not here. Samuel says to Jesse, do you have any more sons? He said, oh yeah, I got this little ruddy lad out taking care of the sheep. He said, bring him. And the least likely person was considered by God to become the king. In 1 Corinthians, it says, God has not chosen the wise of this world, but the fools. Not many wealthy, but the poor things. It goes, I said, God chose the base things. Anytime you think you're something, just remember this. If you're saved, it's only because you were one of the base things of the world. It is a humbling experience. I make myself low. That out of all the world, David, he goes in before the Lord. And he prays after God said, listen, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give you a great name. I'm going to give you a kingdom. You'll never lack a man to sit upon your throne. I'm going to do all this stuff to you. And you can't do anything back. Because he wanted to build a temple for God. He said, no, you can't do that. David goes into the house of the Lord. And he says, when he sat before the Lord, he said, who am I, O sovereign Lord, the God most high, King eternal? And what is my family that you have brought me this far? I come in a sanctuary here sometimes during the week just to pray for you, the church. I come to my spot where I always sit, okay? And as I come to a spot and I'll pray, sometimes I even get on my knees and I pray. And I pray. And when I'm praying, I say, who am I, Lord? Out of all the world, you choose me to be the pastor such a great congregation. Who am I? You see, when you get your head around that we are in harmartia, we're sinners, we're fallen, we've missed the mark, and God has saved us, it's a very humbling thing. You're humbled before him that he, out of all the world, would consider me. He would see me, he would find me, he would seek me out. He would make me the object of love and his grace and his mercy. And he said, and he appointed me into his service. Paul says, out of all the world, I was the worst of all sinners, and he picked me.
And he appointed me, and he placed me into the apostleship. He placed me into a pastorate. Some of you are maybe a nurse, or maybe a carpenter, or maybe a teacher, or I don't know what you do, but you've been appointed by God to be his showcase, the trophy, that others see it and say, wow, I want what they have. I want God to be in God's showcase like they are. He's appointed us. He set us into a mission, a service. We're thankful for his mercy. He says, even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, one commentator said this, Paul was a bully. Even though he was a bully, I was showing mercy. God didn't give me what I deserved because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. I did not know what I was doing. We're thankful for his grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ was poured abundantly upon us. Whereas mercy is withholding the justice we deserve, grace is giving us all the blessings we don't deserve. And so I didn't deserve the gift of eternal life. I deserved eternal damnation, but he withheld that and said he gave me eternal life. He was merciful and he was gracious. And he says, it just pours out. Man, God just pours it out. Just pours that out on me abundantly. Along with faith. For by grace are you saved through faith. You got to go through the doorway of faith. And he says, it is not of yourself. The it refers back to the grace and the faith. Even your faith was a gift from God. Because if God hadn't worked in your heart and worked conviction so that you would confess who he was to be saved, you'd never be saved. He's the one who worked the faith within you. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it's the gift of God. Not of what you do, or otherwise you would boast. And he says he's poured out his love. In Romans chapter 5, it says, the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, which is given unto us. Here he says it's the love of Christ that is poured out on us, that's shed abroad in our hearts. We've got the love of God. You know what we got to do? We got to work that out. We got to get that out. And when we get that love of God out of us, other people are attracted to that, and they want to become Christians too. There's nothing worse than a grouchy, grumpy, miserable Christian when we should be displaying as a trophy of God the love of God in our lives. He goes on and he says here that salvation is secured by faith. He says, Timothy, my son, I give you this instruction, keeping with the prophecies once made about you. Apparently in the church there was a prophecy. They didn't have a Bible at that time. They only had the Old Testament scriptures. But there were New Testament prophets. And a prophet got up and he made a prophecy about Timothy and his ministry. He says, so that by following them you might fight the good fight. You know, there are some things. Our faith is one of them. Our faith is worth fighting for. Life is not always going to be kind to you. Life is not always going to be easy. There's going to be times you're going to say, it's just too much of a struggle. Maintaining my witness at work with my coworkers, where they're harassing and belittling me, this is just too much. He says, no, you fight the good fight. You continue on. I don't know where the struggle might be in your life. He says, but you fight for your faith. We fight in the different areas. I fight with my flesh, temptation every day. My adversary, the devil, see, I fight with him. He knows my weaknesses, and so he puts those before me. He does that to you too. He throws those out there, temptations every day. You fight for your faith. Then there's the whole world itself. I go totally counterculture almost on everything today. If it's what the world says, I can almost say, I might as well do the opposite because that's what God wants. I'm in a battle, I'm a fight, and I fight for my faith every day. He says, fight, you have a faith worth fighting for, so fight the good fight. He says, you have a faith worth holding on to. Hold on to the faith with a good conscience. Hang on. Somebody says, what do you do when you get to the end of your rope? Here's the answer. You tie a knot, you hang on, and you trust God. You hang in there. You hold on. You hold on. Holding on to your faith and a good conscience, some have rejected these and have also have shipwrecked their faith. So I got a shipwreck up here. When I think of shipwreck, I immediately I think, well, how did it wreck? Some ships wreck because there's a storm. Can you imagine being out on the water in a boat and a tsunami come? I can understand how that boat got shipwrecked. The storm of life was so great, it capsized it. Maybe it's a war. There you are, out on, and you're caught between two warring factions. And you get torpedoed. Okay? You could understand how your boat got capsized. We have an adversary. And we're in a spiritual warfare. We wrestle not with flesh and blood, but principalities, powers, and spiritual wickedness in high places. Those are evil, demonic forces. And he says, put on the whole armor of God. Listen, we can be attacked. We could be shipwrecked because we've been attacked. Or maybe it's just a bad design. I'm not in the boat of salvation. I'm in the boat of good works. I'm in the boat that says, I've been baptized. Well, it's not about baptism, it's about salvation. Are you in the boat of salvation? If you're in the wrong boat, you might have a bad design. Maybe it's an incompetent captain. Remember a couple years ago, the cruise liner off the Italian shore ran his ship aground? He was derelict on his duty, and he ran the ship right into the ground. It actually flipped it over on its side. Remember that? An incompetent captain runs it aground. I want to assure you that when you hit a storm and you have Jesus as your captain, you will get through the storm. I don't care what the storm of life is. It could be physical, it could be emotional, it could be financial. I don't know what your storm of life is. You won't capsize with Jesus. When you're attacked and you're connected with Jesus, he will make sure that he is the captain of our salvation. He will protect you. There is no bad design in his salvation. You trust him, he'll take care of everything. He is a competent captain. Now, it says here, some have made shipwreck of their faith, and he names a couple. Among them are Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have handed over to Satan to be taught not to be blasphemers. They were blaspheming the name of Christ, and Paul says, listen, I've just handed them over. I'm not dealing with them. I've just handed them over. Let Satan run his course with their lives, because they've made shipwreck of their faith. I think they might have been in the wrong boat. They weren't in the salvation ship. They were trusting the wrong things. They made shipwreck of their faith. Here's the point. How do we get the most out of our church? How do we get most out of church? We focus on salvation. We don't forget what it's all about. God is in the business of taking ruined, messed up lives and making trophies of his grace out of them. He is in the business of pardoning and forgiving and appointing, because he's considered them valuable, and making them something very valuable and precious in his sight. God is in the business of saving people. People. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I don't know, there might be someone here today who says, you know, I've never experienced the salvation the pastor's talking about. But I want it. I want Jesus as my Savior. I want to be the person for whom he died and he took our sin and buried it in the depth of the deepest sea and removed it as far as the east is from the west. I want to be the person who has the gift of eternal life. I want to be the person who's on the right boat. And Father, I just pray right now they'd say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I admit it. I'm not perfect. Jesus is, and he died for me. I accept that he took my place. And I know that when he died, he was buried, and he rose again. I believe he's alive right now, and I'm calling on him as my Savior, my Lord, my God. I believe in him with all my heart. Lord, I know it's not a prayer that saves you. It's faith to believe that you can pray and ask God to save you, and he will. I know that it's faith in Jesus and what he's done Jesus is the one who saves us. Even as we sang at the beginning, our God saves. So if a person just prayed, Lord, some kind of form or shape of that prayer, and they said, I believe, I have faith, I accept you, Lord, as my Savior. Lord, I know that you'll give them assurance that they are now saved. I pray, Lord, for those who have wandered away and perhaps they know they're just a matter of time, they'll be shipwrecked too because they don't have Jesus as the captain of their boat. When the storm hits, they're likely to go down. Lord, they only have one foot in the boat and the other is dangling over the edge and ready to be pulled out. I pray, Lord, that today they recommit their heart and say, Lord, I want you to be the captain of my boat, captain of my life, captain of my salvation. I want to acknowledge you once again as my Savior, my Lord, my God. I do, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Just prayed a moment ago. You did pray and you asked the Lord to be your Savior. And you say, Pastor, I did that. I prayed and I asked the Lord Jesus to be my Savior. Just raise your hand real quickly. I just want to pray for you. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Perhaps there was someone else that said, you know, I prayed and made a recommitment because I feel like my ship is sinking. I know the Lord, but he just doesn't seem to be my captain. I want to make sure he's captain again. You prayed and you said, Lord, be my captain again. Someone raise their hand and say, yeah, I prayed like that. I prayed like that. Yes. 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 All right. Father in heaven, you've seen the hands that were raised. You know the hearts. We pray, Father, you'd give assurance in their heart that when they prayed that you answered mightily, that you brought the salvation of God. You restored into that full salvation. I pray, Father, that you will bless us now the remainder of this week. We're going to go from this place and we're going to be the trophies of your mercy and your grace, of your love and of faith. May people see that in us and ask for the reason of hope that we have, that we might be bold to open our mouths and tell them about our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, and how he rescued us from the peril of the fall, from our sins, and has given us eternal life, forgiveness and pardon, justification, all the things that go with it. May we be a testimony for you this week. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful Lord's Day. For those who are interested in the baptism class, it'll start in about 15 minutes.